Welcome to On the Margin with E. Ethelbert Miller. My guest today is Eden Raskin. Eden Raskin is the founder and CEO of Chasing the Moon Productions. Eden Raskin is currently working on the film Notes of a Citizen, the Marcus Raskin Story. How are you doing today, Eden?
I'm good. How are you doing?
Okay, we have a lot to talk about. You're joining us during our winter fundraising marathon here.
Oh, perfect.
At WPFW.
And I hope people donate.
Right. And you know, we'll discuss about fundraising.
I know all about it now.
Right. Okay. And we'll tell our listeners to call 202-588-9739. That's 202-588-9739 or 1-800-222-9739 and help us reach our goal of $600 this hour. Eden, what was life like for you before you decided to become a filmmaker?
Interesting question. So I recently-ish decided to become a filmmaker. I don't know. That's like such a broad question. What was it like for me? I grew up, I grew up in a really politically active family. And so that was kind of always at the core of everything that I did and kind of like at the core of my existence in a lot of ways. And, you know, for many years, I think I was kind of really trying to figure out what I was passionate about and what I was excited about. And I dabbled here and there. And now I'm kind of in this place career-wise where I'm really feeling excited and inspired in a way that I have not necessarily before. And, you know, it's very interesting because I'm sure we'll talk about the film a lot and my dad a lot as we get further into this, but my dad kind of had this mentality of, you know, just do it. If you believe it, just do it. And I really did not understand that. And when I was growing up, I always found that kind of frustrating because I was like, you can't just do things. We're all not like this genius like you. And now at this point in my life, I mean, this also comes from a place of privilege as well, but I'm like, oh, I can just do things. And it feels like really liberating. And I think it takes time to kind of get out of your own way to do what you believe in.
You're also doing work as an investigator with the Public Defender Service. What type of skills did you develop there?
So I was an investigator at PDS for a few years, which was probably the most formative experience of my life. I was out in the field every single day. I saw DC fully for the first time, and I'm from DC. So that really says a lot, I think. You know, I love talking to people. And through that, I was like, I can talk to anybody because we're all the same at the root. And I think that was really helpful for me to kind of, I don't know, it's like you just talk to people and just ask questions. And I have never really had a lot of fear in connecting with people and just like kind of going for it. But that really showed me like, I can just do it. I can just make shit happen. And sorry. And it. Okay.
Well, talk about documentary film in terms of how important you see documentary films in general being. And then also, do you have a particular perspective or angle in terms of the type of film you would like to make?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think documentary filmmaking is so important because it really allows people to connect on an emotional level that also brings the truth to the forefront. And I think allowing and creating opportunities to look at something from multiple angles, kind of like in an unfiltered way that documentaries allow for, is really beautiful and really important. And there are so many films out there that dig into these like really specific incidents or emotions, and there's so much universality in all of it that I find really important. And I think that's, you know, it's like in any art, and I think you understand this because you were an artist, you just want to connect with people. Mm-hmm. And I think that documentary filmmaking has such a unique ability to do that. I already forgot what the second part of your question was.
Well, no, I was wondering whether you had a particular way of looking at a documentary film. If I look at your work when it's finished, we'll say, oh, you're using this type of approach.
Yeah. Well, so my documentary is, you know, like artistically, it kind of is going to like meld a few different approaches. We are going to, it's participatory and verite. And so we're filming my journey. And so I'm reluctantly now a part of the film, as well as interviews, as you know, because you were somebody that I interviewed for the film. So it met artistically melds a few different styles into one. And you know, for me, what I want to make sure that I'm doing with this is that I want to be vulnerable and I want to be honest. And I don't want to just tell the history. I want to really dig into the why and the how and the impact and what drove my dad and then what it meant for everybody around him and for the future. And so really looking at the ripples of one's impact, because I think that that's so fascinating. And I think that you know, some people know who my dad is, some people do not, but I think we all create history in our lives. And so how do we tell that story and pay respect to it is what I want to do.
You know, while you are working on your film, you know, we look around and we see many women emerging and becoming visible in the making of films. Do you feel yourself part of a larger community?
I very much do now. It has been really special. So this is my first documentary, and I have really networked and built my community. And I have, you know, kind of coming out of the pandemic when everything is so isolating, it's been really beautiful because people are wildly generous with their time and their resources and have really gone out of their way. And at the heart of that has been a lot of female filmmakers who I think just want to bring people up as they are coming up. And that has been really inspiring to me and something that I hope to do for other people because it means something. And, you know, building communities in every aspect of your life, I think is kind of like what gets you through anything.
You know, I always saw DC, especially before the pandemic, as being a good place for filmmakers. You know, Aviva Kempner, Hadi Garima, there were many people here. Tony Giddens had his film festival. Are you taking advantage of those type of resources? Do you see that, like, I can stay here in DC, I don't have to go somewhere else?
Well, I'm definitely to stay here in DC. I'm DC born and bred. This is my home. My family's here. I, you know, my husband's business is here. My kids are, you know, it's this is DC is my home. But yes, I very much think, you know, Aviva, somebody, the first person you said, Aviva was the first person that I called when I said I was decided I was going to do this. And she has been wildly encouraging and supportive. And she is such a talented filmmaker who focuses on a lot of untold stories. And I think that that is something that's appealing to both of us in a lot of ways. And yeah, there is a really huge network of artists and, you know, of course, politicians and the opportunity to focus on making an impact and impact productions and impact filmmaking in the city. But I'm also, you know, now I'm making connections throughout the country and ultimately, I want to make sure that this film has as wide a reach as possible.
Okay. Well, you know, you are making a film about your father, Marcus Raskin, and we know that Mark Raskin was one of the founders back in 1963 of the Institute for Policy Studies with Richard Barnett. The Institute for Policy Studies is a progressive think tank. We know that your father died on December 24th, 2017. But talk about, introduce your father to our listeners.
Introduce my father to the listeners. That is hard. You did, you know, what you kind of did a very good overview of who he is and how people might know him. What I wanted to do with this film, and I can kind of go deeper into the film right now
Well,
if
don't
you're.
talk about the film. Just talk about Mark Raskin.
Well, it's hard because they're the same.
Okay, all
Film
right.
is my
Okay.
dad, and so I'll go a little bit into the film because it's about how I talk
Okay,
about him.
right.
And so the documentary is really my follows my journey of discovery into this really prolific and tumultuous time in my dad's life in the 1960s and 70s when he was indicted with the Boston Five for Vietnam draft resistance. He co-founded the Institute for Policy Studies, which was infiltrated by the FBI for several years. He helped release the Pentagon Papers, was on Nixon's enemies list. And two of his colleagues were tragically assassinated by a foreign dictator on US soil, just blocks from his office in DC. And I knew all of these things, but I didn't really know any of the details, and I didn't ask questions while I had the chance. And so now I like to say I'm asking everybody else but him. On top of all of that, he was also a concert-trained pianist. And for me, his music was really the soundtrack to my life. And that's how this whole film started. And so I think it's really interesting because you have this public figure that everybody knows, and then you have, to me, someone who was just dad. And how do you kind of like reconcile those two things in a person? And there's this also interesting piece of how much can you really know someone by the way that they present themselves to you? And, you know, my dad, I think you would say this, everybody says this in an interview, and this is how I remember him the best, is that he just connected with people and he wanted to talk to everybody, and he got people because he listened. And that I think is one of the lessons that I hope to learn from him so deeply. Besides all of the incredible things that he did, he was a good person.
My guest today is Eden Raskin. She is the founder and CEO of Chasing the Moon and with production. And we're talking about the film she's working on right now, Notes of a Citizen, the Marcus Raskin Story. This is a question, Eden. You are a Raskin. What does being a Raskin mean to you? And I say that because, you know, many people know because your brother, you know, the Raskin name has become like a household name. But what does it mean to you? I mean, when you talk about your father, when you see your brother on TV, it must mean something to you. It must have a weight of responsibility. Maybe that's why the energy of doing this film is so important. But what does it mean to be a Raskin?
That's a really great, kind of a heavy question in a lot of ways. But I do want to say that this is fundraising. I really hope that we reach this $600 goal in this hour.
Thank you.
So I encourage people to call right now. What does it mean to be a Raskin? I mean, I think that my dad set a really good example for all of us growing up, and for also, I have a million younger nieces and nephews too. And for all of us to kind of stand up for what we believe in and stand up for the voiceless. And that is, I think, part of what it means to be Raskin. I think it's also, it's what it means to be a person and what we should all strive for. And, you know, I keep just saying connecting with people, but connecting and listening. And, you know, I think my dad was so successful and Jamie's so successful because they listen to what people are saying and then are able to act accordingly, not just based on what they think is right, but based on what people are telling them and what they need. And I think that that is a kind of the root of achieving progress in a lot of ways. But yes, I'm very proud of my brother. It is, you know, a lot of people, when I'm talking about the film, come up and talk to me about how much they love him. And that means so much because I'm so deeply proud of him every day. And yeah, I don't know. I think it's not necessarily a name, but it's, that is the weight. It's kind of what we should do as a person.
Well, you know, you talk about, and I've seen the trailer of the film, you know, this desire to know your father better. Did you have to overcome a degree of sadness and loss while making the film? And was there any time when you felt you were too close to your subject?
Oh, definitely. So I had actually, while my dad was still alive, I decided that I wanted to just record him playing the piano because for me, that was so deeply important to me. And so I had enlisted a good friend of mine from college to just do me a favor and film my dad. My friend is a filmmaker. And when he agreed, I said, oh, we'll just interview my whole family while we're at it and just make a weekend. And so we did this. And then later that year, my dad unexpectedly passed and I was not able to do anything with the footage. I couldn't even watch it for years until now, about 2 years ago. So that was a pretty solid chunk of time in there where I couldn't even watch it because it was too heavy and I missed him too much. And so basically when I watched all this footage for the first time, I was like, oh, there is this huge story that's just begging to be told, and I'm the one to tell it. And we not only have these deeply personal glimpses into my dad's life, but also into our country's history, and kind of this, in a way, forgotten and hidden history. And so that was really fascinating to me, too. Initially, the film was just about my dad. I was not going to be a part of it at all. And because of what you said, because of the closeness to the subject, that felt disingenuous to kind of remove myself from that process. Also because my grief is a part of the process. And grief can be wildly isolating, but is so universal. And so in sharing my journey in this, if I can connect with anybody and they can see themselves in me, that means a lot to me, because when I was grieving, I felt alone. And so if, you know, somebody else can be like, yes, I feel that way. I feel that heaviness. I feel that sadness. I'm not alone in it. That means something.
If I was a high school teacher or even a college professor, and I wanted to use your film in my classroom, what does your film tell a young person about citizenship, since your film is Notes of a Citizen, the Marcus Raskin story? What would be conveyed through the film that I would say, oh, okay, I get this. This is what I should be doing as a citizen in the United States.
That's a really great question. my dad, so the title Notes of a Citizen is a nod to one of his books, Essays of a Citizen. And my dad, this kind of feels bad to say, but I'm really reading his work for the first time. And obviously doing so much research and learning so much and coming to understand that my dad, along with the people that he was working with, laid the groundwork for today's modern progressive movement. And a lot of what he was fighting for 60 years ago is what we're fighting for today. And so that feels really scary, but it also can be really inspiring, because I think a lot can be learned from the successes of his generation and his activism and the ongoing fight for progress that was not always linear. And there were setbacks and there were really hard moments of it. But, you know, I think he shows that if you keep going and if you really believe in something, then you can make a difference. And, you know, he talks about your role, our role as a citizen. And when my dad was, he was indicted with the Boston Five in 1968 for a conspiracy to aid and abet Vietnam draft resistance. Funnily enough, he didn't even know any of his co-defendants before they were indicted together, but somehow it was a conspiracy. And he said, I was indicted because I was unwilling to cheapen my role as a citizen. And I think that that is something that we should all kind of channel in our lives in a lot of way. And so I want, you know, for younger people, people my age, people younger than me, I'm not so young anymore, college students and high school students, to watch this and really understand that it is my role to stand up for what I believe in and see it worked before. We have been in this place in some way before and we got through it. And so we can get through it today. It just takes time and work and dedication and passion.
I saw your father as a philosopher. And I'm listening to what you said in terms of looking at your father's work and learning and reading it. And I was wondering whether, when you look at your father's work, are there any things in his work that speaks to you as a woman?
That speaks to me as a woman? There hasn't been something in his work that has spoken to me as a woman per se. I think more as just a person and as a citizen and kind of seeing my role in that way. In one of my interviews, though, that I did with somebody who she has, Sarah Anderson, who you know, who's been at IPS for several years, and she started when she was really young, and she was always very timid at the beginning. And my dad kind of was like, come speak at this, Sarah, what do you think? And brought her out of meetings. And he was like, why don't you speak more? He was like, you, as a woman, you need to speak more and make your voice heard. And that really resonated with her and really resonated with me also when she shared that, because we all have something of value to add. And I think as women, sometimes that is overlooked or undermined. And so having someone that is so established and empathetic and inspiring and a name, be like, what you say matters. And just because you are a person and because you're a woman. And so I think that that has resonated with me more than anything that I read of his, just what he shared and how he treated the people that he knew.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I would say Sarah Anderson is key to the running of IPS right now.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
And I would say that some of the things that your father told me really encouraged me to do more.
I'd love to know what. Can I ask you?
Well, you know what happened? I remember I was in his office and he pulled me aside and he said, you are the best chair of our organization we've ever had. And that meant a lot to me. You know, I didn't come there to be a chairperson, you know. And, you know, sometimes people would say publicly, well, our organization is led by a poet. You know, like, yeah, that's why we don't have any money, right? Okay. But you know what I'm saying? For him to say that, you know, and I looked at all the people that, you know, were ahead of me as chair of the organization. You know, I felt that was very humbling, but it was also, I was hearing that from the founder of the organization. You know, and not some, you know, CEO or whatever, but this is the person who built the organization. So I felt their responsibility to make sure that this dream is kept alive, you know. And I think that's important. Before we go to our break, Eden, I want to ask you a question about, this film is about your father, but how much is this film also about the history of the Institute for Policy Studies?
Well, my dad and the Institute for Policy Studies, IPS, are in so many ways one. So IPS is a huge part of the story. It was a huge part of my dad's life. It was a huge part of his identity and also my life and my siblings' life as well. So IPS is definitely going to be featured pretty prominently at times. And, you know, my dad was working there at the time of the indictment, the assassination, releasing the Pentagon Papers, and all of this wild FBI monitoring and COINTELPRO and everything that was touched on in the earlier segment today. That's where he was, and that was the backdrop. And IPS and my dad were really feared in a lot of ways by the government because they asked questions and they challenged the status quo.
Did you have an outline, you know, okay, in terms of, we know that you're dealing with your father and learning about father, but, you know, this, you know, the same way if you're writing a memoir, you know, you have to say, okay, I know where it's going to begin. I know where it's going to end. Did you have an outline in terms of this film?
So the film is still in production. So I'm still doing interviews and research at this point. But yes, it started not with an outline, but with a general idea of kind of the topics that were going to be covered. And so the founding of IPS was going to be one, the FBI monitoring, the Boston Five, and him as a pianist is basically this like undercurrent throughout the film. And then the assassination. The Pentagon Papers, I thought, were going to be a bullet point. At this, I have learned so many shocking things about that. And that's now the arc of the story in a lot of ways. And so it's changed. And I think you kind of, with anything that you are doing in life artistically or not, you have to be willing to change as you learn more. And so the story has definitely evolved from what it began as. But I started with a general idea, and that has shifted and very much grown since the beginning. But I have I think I have a clear understanding of where we're going with it.
Okay, this is like sort of a spiritual question, you know, because you are dealing with your dad. Do you feel that he's perhaps guiding you through this film?
Oh my gosh, yes, very much so. He is so with me in this process. It's wild. And it's just, there have been so many little serendipitous moments that have happened throughout the filming where something just appears at the exact moment that I need it. He's here. There's no other way to describe it. And that is beautiful. And I think through just talking to people and learning more than I am, all that I am, I feel closer to him, which is very special. But there's even actually, Ethelbert, a moment with you. I don't know if you remember, but you gave me a bunch of materials before your interview, and I went through all of it. And then I was going up to interview Cora and Peter Weiss in New York like the next day. So I cleared out your folder and put in all of the new information for Cora and Peter. And when I was prepping for their interview that morning out in New York, I had forgotten to take out one thing that you had given me. And I didn't even look at it the night before because I was rushing so much. And it was an email from Cora and Peter to my dad. And I didn't even know I had it. And it was in this folder that I'm seeing for the first time. It shouldn't have been in this folder. And it was there. And then I was able to talk to them about this like beautiful, heartfelt birthday tribute that they had written to him. And it was like this little moment of like, what? Why did it happen in this silly way? But it did.
So we look at Nose of a Citizen, the Marcus Raskin story. What will your film reveal to people who knew Marcus Raskin? Say, go, oh, I didn't know this. You know, that there's something that you come to in your film and say, oh, I never knew that. Is there anything like that?
So there's a lot of moments like that. there's a lot of kind of huge moments of discovery. I have had huge moments of learning information that has really challenged my understanding of my dad in ways that I was not expecting at all. And that has been a process for me and will be part of the film and something that I kind of talked to my siblings about, and seeing someone more fully for the first time, especially a parent, is kind of a wild ride. and I think for me, my dad was always kind of on a pedestal. And then in his death, he became sainted to me. And so to see the complexity in his humanity is really grounding, honestly. And he was just a person doing the best that he could, and he was not perfect. And that has been, I think, now at my point in the, at this point in my life, really helpful for me to understand. And I hope that people also kind of see that people that do great things aren't perfect. So you can also do great things. Mm-hmm. But then the people that knew him, I interviewed John Cavana for five, who's the former director of the Institute for Policy Studies. I interviewed him for 5 hours a few weeks ago. And there was a lot that I shared with him that he did not know, and he was kind of in disbelief about. So that's also this funny part now, because I'm so deep into this that I'm now the expert. Even though I didn't live through any of this, I kind of have a more complete picture. And so it's funny to talk to my siblings and have them share what their memories were of us being six. Jamie was six when Dad was indicted with the Boston Five, and what that was like for him, and then me filling out the rest of the story for him. And it's been a process.
I always think of your father with a sense of humor. Is there any funny story that you remember captures your father during your childhood?
I mean, my dad like just spoke to everybody. And so at times I was like, oh, must we? Like, we're in a hurry, is there? But he also, I don't know. What I think was so great about him is that he was so unapologetically himself. He never put on fake airs about anything. He would go to an interview with like a rumpled suit and stains on it. My mom and I would always have to like try to fix him up before he did something like that. And he just didn't care. He was like, this is who I am. There was one time, I don't know why I'm going to share the story right now, but so this is when Jamie was running for state senate, and I was working on his campaign, and we were making huge signs for the 4th of July parade for people to hang on their houses. And so we were up like all night, and my boyfriend at the time came over, and my dad was hanging out with all of us. And my dad brought out a book of, and my boyfriend, he was like kind of like timid and shy. And my dad brought out a book of Martin Luther King's speeches and started playing the piano, and then made my boyfriend read I Have a Dream while my dad played the piano. And he was like, more passion, more passion. And it was like the most, but it was such this, I don't know. It was.
Well, you know, you are your father's dream, Eden Raskin. And I want to end there. We're coming to the end of our show. But, you know, I know that you had a lot of these stories and I just wanted you to end with one.
Can I just say really quickly that Amy Goodman was saying that Democracy Now, their motto is speaking truth to power, which is the Institute for Policy Studies motto as well. And I think at this time when there are such one-sided stories out there, having WPFW is so critically important. And so we can talk about human rights stories, we can talk about politics, and we can talk about humanity in a real way. So support. There's 4 minutes left. I want
okay. All right. Okay. Thank you, Eden Raskin. They have to play music. Okay. So, all right. Thank you very much. My name is Ethelbert Miller. The show's On the Margin, the station WPFW 89.3 FM.